All right, this is Charles Hockett, 16 Design Features for Human Language, or the Distinction Between Animal and Human Language. So basically the research question in theory is, what is language? But instead of just looking at it in and of itself, which is kind of something that can and perhaps does go on forever, it's essentially looking at human communication versus animal communication, very much in that order. So human being the priority, let's say, and animal being the different, the other, the inferior as well. So this is, most of these are from the Origins of Speech from 1960, which is an article you can and probably should read before getting stuck into this topic. It's about 6 pages long, it's full of diagrams, it's quite accessible. Basically, if you look in their little aqua or quality image down there, that's the first 13 features from this article, and this actual diagram, or a very similar one, is in the original article for you to read. And then basically what he's done is he's used these features and run them alongside some examples of animal language that are considered, you know, good or human-like, and then found, basically run whether or not those things are present in the animal group or not. So this should be your starting point, and the article should be your kind of point of port of call, let's say. So we're using an article that grouped them in a different way than the original article to give us a bit of structure, but your job is to think of how you can put all these 16 together in an order and a meaningful way. So duality of pattern basically means that there's the sounds and then there's the language. So the G sound, A, N, E, are 4 pretty meaningless sounds by themselves, but when you put them together to say game, you've got something meaningful. So you think of these are sort of your two patterns, your two channels. One is the sounds and one is kind of the meaning. So if you think of listening to someone who speaks a language that you don't understand, you can hear the sound, but you can't make out the meaning. So those are the dualities of patterning. Productivity, using the language, you can make an infinite amount of things happen. So as the image on the above my head, blocked by my head perhaps, it is possible to create something that's never been done before, to say a sentence that no one has ever said, to think a thought that no one has ever thought, and to, you know, produce that in language, I guess. So productivity is what's possible with language. Arbitrariness basically says that the words or the sounds that we match to objects are completely arbitrary. They have no real basis or link. So, you know, a tree, we call a tree from the Latin arbor. So you think of, you know, arbory, there's words associated with the original Latin, but we call it tree, other languages call it different things. So they're sort of completely arbitrary over here. Somewhere in the middle, there's onomatopoeia, which is the word that we use to describe sounds that we write as words, like punch, biff, bong, slap, crack, pop, things like that. So the image we have here is the woof sound of a dog, which we think of as woofs, other languages don't. So to us, when a dog does what it does, we hear woof. Say Russian, they hear gav, French, wau, Japanese, wan. And you can see the fact that language is arbitrary means that none of these really, like if you ran them together, there's not really anything in common. Maybe the W sound in 2 of them, 3 of them, but even still, they're quite distinct. So arbitrariness, the sounds, the words have no relation to the actual thing directly, except for the one that we give it, which is an arbitrary choice. Interchangeability basically means you can hear a message, you can communicate a message, you can do both. It's not a one-way thing, like some animals can communicate, but they can't receive, or vice versa. Specialisation, the purpose of the human language is to communicate, and that's what it's for, whereas some animal languages have a primary purpose as well, which is different to that. Whereas the human language, the purpose is communication. Displacement means that I can talk about me yesterday, me when I was born, in Narnia, a made up place, in the future I will do this, in an alternate timeline I will do this. It basically means I'm not bound by my present reality. So if you think of a dog, if they bark, that means they're scared or happy or whatever in the moment, whether or not they ever bark or whimper from previous memories or thoughts of the future, hard to say, but we know for sure that human language is possible of doing that. Cultural transmission basically means that the signified and signifier all go together, and we communicated them in a cultural way. So you learn the words, you learn the meanings, you learn how the language fits into your worldview. So those are the first seven. Now we're on to the next six. These are kind of the more primary ones, perhaps. Vocal auditory channel, so in the 1960s, sign language, Auslan, BSL, British Sign Language, all those things weren't really that sort of important, let's say, in linguistics. Basically, we call it oracy, which is sort of focused very much on the spoken word at that point. So to him, vocal auditory channel is one feature of a language that's required, I guess. So if you're signing according to this original description, you're not actually communicating. But you know, obviously people changed and fixed that up later. So broadcast, transmission, and directional reception is very complex, sounds complicated, but it's not really. It basically means when I talk, it goes out like that in a cone, and the people hear it kind of like that in their ears, and they can sort of think that it's directed at them. Basically, that's all there is to it. Rapid fading or transitoriness. Transitory means it's gone. Ephemeral means it's gone very quickly, like the, you know, like a sandcastle on the beach, but perhaps even quicker. As soon as I've said something and it's left my mouth, that's sort of it. Unless someone made a recording, video, TikTok of it, then it's just gone into the air. Total feedback means as I speak, if I make a mistake, I can hear it being fed back through my own ears, and then I can make corrections as I need to. Semanticity basically means that words have meaning. The symbols, the words, the letters, the sounds have meanings. Simple as that. Semantics, semanticity, more or less the same thing. Meanings of words. Discreteness, the language is made up of small little bits that you can mix and match and jumble up and do in different ways. So we've got here the Scrabble two-letter word list. Using just these, I'm sure there's hundreds of thousands of words that you could produce using these discrete little chunks. All right, so these are the final three from A Note on Design Features from 1966. So they're kind of like him going back and sort of trying to fix up his work a little bit, clean up his notes, so to speak. Prevarication basically means that using language, you can say something that is not true. So I'm not bound to tell you the truth. I could say I'm actually a short, middle-aged woman, and that is me prevaricating, which basically means lying or avoiding the truth. Reflexiveness is basically the meta language, the fact that using language, we can communicate about language. So I can write about writing, I can speak about speaking, I can teach about speaking and writing, and linguistics itself is probably the truest representation of the reflexiveness of our language, which is basically that using our language, we can look at our language. And learnability basically means that even though I was born in and acquired one language, I can learn others. So I can, you know, in theory, I could probably learn multiple hundreds of languages, and that is possible. I'm not kind of bound, like, you know, I was born in Australia, so I'm sort of locked in any way to Australian English. There's other things that I can learn and other languages that I can train myself to understand. And then your job is just basically define these and group them together in a way that makes sense to create a taxonomy. Basically, a taxonomy is a way of grouping information that makes sense. A nice easy example is Maslow's hierarchy of needs. So he's got the things that human beings need are food, shelter, and self-actualization. There's probably others. And then he's put it into a pyramid of kind of, you know, importance. Your job is to do something similar, a bit of a visual aid. Put these together in a way that makes sense. You might want to start by ranking them from most important to least, and then group them based off that. You're also welcome to exclude some as well when you talk about them. Cheers. So here's an example, nine features. What they've done is common to all communication systems and not found in all communication systems. This is something that you could do as well, one way of looking at it, but it's entirely up to you to create an appendix that outlines the 16 features with your notes on them and groups them in a way that makes sense to you.